You're listening to the More Than the Music podcast, episode 37, featuring Crowder.
I've had a number of people in my life that have struggled with a lot of addiction stuff, and it's hard to watch, you know. I felt the same time I'm in the same boat. I mean, it's the story's the same for all of us. Mm-hmm. That's part of what I love about getting to tell this story over and over, and why it's told over and over in the scriptures. It's the story of humanity. And I think if you find that commonality, then you feel more connected and you put faces and names to a struggle that you can then see in yourself. I love about this song, though, that it does then point to the cross and
and
a thing that looks incredibly dire and devastating can be turned to tell a story of the grandeur of what rescue looks like and what redemption looks like.
You're about to hear how the movie Rocky inspired Crowder to start playing music, why he felt called to help start a church while he was in college, the reason he believes music is really about community, and what song on American Prodigal he laughed at while it was being recorded. I'm Justin Paul, along with Crowder, and we're going to talk about a lot more than just the music.
More Than the Music is hosted by Justin Paul, a touring musician turned national radio personality who loves the dramatic, humorous, sometimes tragic, and often inspiring story behind the songs from your favorite artists. You can connect with the show at wayfm.com/Justin. Now here's your host, Justin Paul.
I am so excited to be joined on the More Than the Music podcast by Mr. David Crowder. How you doing, sir?
I'm doing fantastic. Thank you for having me.
Hey, man. Thanks for being here. We're going to talk about the songs on the album American Prodigal. Great album. I've listened to this thing all the way through, man. Fantastic work.
Thank you.
I don't know.
Glad it kept your attention.
I don't know if I'm supposed to say that. Like,
is that? Well, I want you to.
Yeah.
I want to be like, hey, I like your record. I can listen to four songs, and then
just those four
one
songs.
One of the first
man.
Times I went to any radio get together. This is for real. Like our first time, we were the David Crowder Band. It was our first GMA week in Nashville, Tennessee. It was a big time. It was like, this is where you got. It's gonna make or break your career. I really had this gal from Orlando come up to me and go, "Oh, you're David Crowder," and I go, "Yeah." And she goes, "Ah, your music puts my kid right to sleep." And she knew what she was doing in that moment. And I almost quit. I almost stopped.
Almost called it quits.
But now I'm still going. So thanks for listening to the whole thing. And I'm glad it held your attention. That makes me
feel
resilient.
Well, I'm so glad we're going to get to hear the stories behind the songs. But let's start back how it all got started for you. You're from Waco, Texas, right? And that's where it kind of began?
No. But it's...
Texarkana.
I understand. That's it.
So
it,
that's not close.
No, it's real close. Okay. I mean, it's sort of close. I mean, it's in the same state. Texas is like huge.
It's a big state.
Texarkana, Texas. On the northeast corner of the state, half of it's in Arkansas, half of it's in Texas. So I barely made it in Texas, thank goodness.
Okay.
And then I went to Waco to go to school at Baylor in like 93. And then I helped start a church there my junior year of college. And then I got stuck in Waco for about 16 years. And then I just moved to Atlanta, Georgia. And that's like how I'm here now.
You say stuck in Waco, Texas. Were you trying to get out the whole time?
it's just like circles and circles. No, it's the Baylor Bear fan Sikkim Bears thing that you just can't leave because it's just so exciting. The sporting events that are there are just so compelling. You have to stay around and see how it goes. And year after year, we are so close.
Now, growing up, was your family a musical family, or how'd you jump into this whole thing?
Well, none of them played music, but they had a piano. And so, I don't know.
Just
that was
there?
Confusing. It's like a point of mystery in the Crowder lure. I don't know why the piano was there since no one played it. My dad, I don't know, he's like late 60s right now. He's now learning to play a piano, so it's never too late. But we had the piano there the whole time. That's all I'm saying. You know, we could have gotten started earlier, but anyway, I at a young age understood that it was a thing you could touch as a young child that made a lot of racket.
Yes.
And then so I would do that, and then my mom noticed that the things that I was banging, she recognized the melody of and thought, well, maybe we should get the kid lessons, and then started sending me to piano lessons. So I started like piano lessons early, and I hated all of it. No, for real, man. You don't know what it feels like. Okay, here's the deal. Remember daylight savings time when you're a kid and you have to go to bed and it's like already like it's still light outside.
Yeah.
And so all the cool parents like let their kids stay up for one, and then like they're playing Nerf football, and then also you are at a piano practicing. And your mom's like, "Hey, I'm treating you because you don't have to go to bed right now." And then you're like, "Yeah, this feels great."
You can only play Itsy Bitsy Spider so much before it gets really annoying.
For me, it was all like movie and TV theme songs. Like my first recital was the Rocky theme because it was my favorite movie.
Okay, that sounds cool. Yeah. That sounds like something Crowder would play as a kid.
You know, it's really cool. It's like got me hooked on music was Rocky.
A boxing movie.
Yeah.
That's hilarious.
It's the same movie as Whiplash, which is a music movie, but it's the same movie. Like, do you know the movie Whiplash?
I guess.
It's about the little kid that goes to
the school. Drumming kid?
Yeah. So he goes to school and learns to play the drums, but it's a very aggressive education.
I see the correlation.
Remember?
Now, yeah.
But the same feeling I had as a kid watching Rocky III, I remember this, watching Rocky III, standing on a seat in a theater with my hands on the seat in front of me, like, I want to fight my brother right now. And then that feeling that you can do and be anything you want to be, it's the same feeling I had watching the Whiplash movie.
And then playing the piano.
I was also at an adult age standing on my seat in the theater with having a seat in front of me.
Growing up in Texas, I would imagine very conservative family, very like straight-laced, by the book.
Not early
on. In church
on.
Every Sunday.
No,
kind
not
of thing.
Early on. Here's what's weird. Okay, I mean, yes. I thought I was born in the nursery of First Baptist Church, Texas. I really did. But here's what happened. So as a kid, though, growing up, I can remember, I mean, far long enough to remember like what was being played in the car. And my dad had this old Thunderbird that I thought was amazing. He was an insurance agent in town, and I thought it was like the coolest car that existed in Texarkana, Texas. It was a light blue Thunderbird, but not like the cool old classic kind, but like the brand new kind.
Yeah.
It had the sticker on the window that he was like real proud of. It had the like electric windows that rolled down, had the seats that would go back and forth with like push of a button, things that we take for granted now.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? Lights that had like things hiding them, and then you hit a switch and they flip up like that.
Yeah.
We're like, we are doing things,
like the
Corvette
Dad.
Lights.
You're
doing things. Had an 8-track player in the deal, and I can remember there were like 4 8 tracks in rotation. It was like Willie Nelson, Elvis, Bill Gaither, and Olivia Newton-John. I tell everybody that's everything I've done in music my whole career. It's his fault. But then suddenly, at one point, now Bill Gaither made the cut, but at one point, suddenly all of the secular music was banned in our house. It disappeared. And so I had to go through certain hurdles to convince my dad that Queen was a Christian band. And I was successful in it at a young age. He was our soccer coach. And so we chose as our theme song for our soccer team, the Challengers, because it's a challenge every time you're on the field, you know, and you got to give yourself to the challenge, just like Rocky, just like Whiplash. But so we'd play Another One Bites the Dust. He would bring a jam box. My dad would bring a jam box in his boots. I've never seen him wear any shoes in my whole life other than cowboy boots. But he'd bring his boots and his jam box to the soccer field, and he'd play Another One Bites the Dust. If we lost that weekend, we'd go to the pizza place. He would go to the jukebox, and he'd hit Another One Bites the Dust. If we won, he'd go to the jukebox at the pizza place.
How do you coach soccer
in
cowboy boots?
That was my point. You didn't miss that. Thank you. Also, how do you roof a house in cowboy boots? I remember as a small child going, Dad, these are the worst boots. This is not good. This is not good. It's not safety. So one night, a Sunday night at First Baptist Church, Texarkana, where I was born, there's a traveling evangelist coming through town, speaking the ills of secular music and how it's warping the minds of the young children today.
Mm.
And would you know the first song that he played as example of this would be Queen, Another One Bites the Dust. I've never prayed that hard in my whole life. It's like, Jesus, please come now, or don't let him stop talking.
Yeah. So he figured out that moment that Queen was not a Christian band.
He understood it. But that's also the same moment I discovered AC/DC. So it was good and bad about that whole situation.
My parents were the same way. I asked once if I could listen to country music, and they told me only if it spoke of chicken and cows.
So that, you were good.
Yeah. Like, all I had to do was find a song that just talked about, like, farm animals, and I could listen to that. That was it.
Okay, now I'm thinking about that, and I don't know that there's...
There's probably not any. That was the point.
There
yeah.
are some Bill Gaither songs. Like, I'm thinking of Cattle on a Thousand Hills.
Yeah.
We got that one. So we were...
Sorry. Livestock. As long as the song had livestock, I could listen to that as a kid. So you moved to Baylor, and then in your junior year, you helped start a church. Like, what college kid does that?
Yes, who had, yeah, that's
yeah.
a terrible idea. You're right.
No,
that's exactly what I was thinking the whole
idea.
Time. No,
I'm
I thought
saying
it was
unique.
No, it was like a crazy idea. The guy that was a friend of mine who started the church, he told me to one of the first meetings we had with like the Southern Baptist Mission Association of Texas. And we're going into a room with a lot of people that are older than us because we're both in college at the time.
Mm-hmm.
He was too, and he was also in undergrad. I think he was in undergrad still, but. We're going in a room of people with all these suits on, and I'm like, this is such a terrible idea. And my friend Chris starts telling, here's the deal. Baylor has done a survey of their student population and discovered over half the students that's at a Christian school in the middle of Texas, your state, that don't step foot in church their whole stay at school. And we don't think it's a rejection of the person of Jesus. We believe it's a rejection of the institutional experience that they've had. And we would like for us to be able to carve out a space that lets them set down some of their baggage and reclaim the truth of what the story of Jesus is. And man, I'm like, this is not going good, man. We should have worn something better than what we have. I should have got a haircut, that kind of deal. And at the end of the table, I'll never forget, this guy who you can tell is running the thing just by nonverbals starts weeping, like he starts crying. And it's like, Chris, you're talking about my grandkids. They go to your school. You're right. I don't know how to reach them. If you're willing to be there and figure out a way to connect them back to the story of God that I know they are aware of, we're with you. And then they helped us find a building, and we were off and running in a short time thereafter.
And then that's kind of where David Crowder Band started too, right?
Exactly.
Right in the church.
Yeah. The reason I was even in that meeting is because Chris thought I was somewhat musically inclined, because he'd heard me tell stories about playing the Rocky theme and that sort of thing. My only role was really just like a MD, like a music director role, where I just find the players, find the songs, help rehearse. I didn't sing. I just played keys like in the back and made sure everybody was doing
that. That was
back
before Planning Center too, right? Before it got all sophisticated.
Oh,
yeah.
Yeah. That was before like music. No, it was really tough to find songs that fit the collegiate setting. I mean, you're college kids, you listen to college radio, and at the time, like Dave Matthews Band's like the biggest thing on the planet. That's what everybody's going to. And the way we got kids into church, we just went to all the frat and sorority meetings and said, hey, we're starting a church for you guys. And so it was tough to find music that fit their vocabulary, their musical instincts. And really, the music seemed the simple part. The harder part's how do you form community in a culture that's very dissected and individualistically minded. So the music seemed like to be the easy part to us. We didn't understand all the culture wars and the conflict about progressive music versus, you know, something that's been a little bit more liturgical and historically vetted. We just thought music is simple. We all like it. Why don't we sing something that feels like what's coming from inside of us? And that was what led us to writing some songs about a year in.
If you can't find a genre to sing, you just make your own. Like this folktronica, is that what you describe Crowder as?
Well, that's where we eventually got to, I guess. I thought I made that word up. And then, so then the Neon Steeple record, that's the first solo record that we put out, or I put, we, I don't know why I talk about me in plural. It makes sense. Okay. Sorry, everybody talked back to me in my mind just then, so I get it. Anyway, we put out that Neon Steeple record, and I was trying to describe to my friends, what's your new stuff sound like? I was like, I don't know. It's like a lot of Appalachian mountains type thing, but then also like Ibiza or like 808 kick drums sits next to the banjo, you know, ones and zeros next to the fiddle, that kind of deal. And they just stared at me, and so finally I was like, you know, it's like kind of folk music meets like electronic dance music. It's like folktronica. A lot of folk, a lot of tronica. And then they were like, oh, yeah, that makes sense. I get it. And I'm like, man, that's a very clever
word.
Just
made that up.
I just made that up. Well, record goes out, and we've been talking about like folktronica. I feel so clever. And then somebody on Twitter, like, you know, mean tweets me. Is like, this is like a genre. It's on Wikipedia. Look it up.
It's and on I'm like, Wikipedia.
So I look it up, and I'm like, sure enough, it says folktronica is a genre of music. And there's like three other artists that apparently are part of it. And dude, you totally made this Wikipedia page. Like, you kidding me? I can read when it started. But Beth Orton was a part of it. And so then I felt very valid and affirmed in my position. It's a great genre.
Really,
it's a growing genre.
It
doesn't have like a placard card at Best Buy yet, but it's growing.
Is it a channel on Pandora?
No,
probably not yet.
But hey, eventually something will free up.
Yeah.
You know?
Got to move one genre out before we can make room for the other one.
Thanks. You know, creative destruction is hard, but you got to live with it.
So you said recently you moved to Atlanta a couple of years ago, right? Like, what was that change like, moving from Texas to Atlanta, becoming a solo artist? Was there any fear in that at all?
Not initially, because I'm not good at foresight or thinking ahead. So I didn't see that there wasn't fear. But then when I got there, I was scared to death because it's like a lot of traffic. You know?
Yes.
Seriously, I sold my car. I don't drive anymore. Just Uber.
Just
I
Uber
sold,
every day.
Yeah, I sold my car. That's
incredible.
No, it's amazing. Actually, it's amazing because, you know, that UberX deal, I don't mean this to be like a commercial. You could insert any company that, you know, has an app that you can like call them immediately and they come pick you up for like $6 to get across town while you're like doing your work. You can do your email and stuff. It's like It's what Britney Spears and Lindsay Lohan, they needed this back in the day. They needed these things to just like get a, like, I'm like, hey man, you're famous. Like, why don't you have your own driver? Hey, I'm Crowder. I'm a solo artist. I do. It's called Uber X. I pay $6 while I get my work done. And everybody's safer.
Yes. Everybody is safer.
And I'm less angry. Things just all around are looking up for Atlanta.
I grew up in Georgia, but Atlanta was like a destination because I grew up in the deep South, like 3 hours from Atlanta. Okay. So we would go to Atlanta, and as a small town South Georgia boy, you're like overwhelmed with the traffic. You know, you have to call your city friend to drive you around because you're so scared to drive.
That's my point. Yeah. No, like when I first got there, you know, like Chris Tomlin.
Yeah.
He lived there. He's like, I live in Atlanta. I'm like, oh my gosh, I should move to Atlanta. Because you're like my friend, I should move there. No, he and Louie Giglio, they started this church called Passion City Church. But so Louie and Chris live there, and they're like some of the best friends I've had. I've known them for years. The whole time I've been making music, they've been in my life and know me in a very deep way. And so I'm like, this is going to be great. I'm going to move to Atlanta. We're going to be great friends. And so I get there, and I'm like, hey, Chris, what, do you want to go to lunch or something? He's like, yeah, man, let's just meet at such and such. And he sends me like the little pin thing, and I'm like, oh my word, that's like in Tennessee. Like, people that live in Atlanta, they call Atlanta. It's not Atlanta. He's like way up north. I drove for, this is my first lunch meeting, I think it was with Chris. We were going to go get barbecue at some place he wanted to meet at in Roswell, Georgia. Roswell is not Atlanta, Georgia, especially when there's traffic.
Yes.
And I'm driving for about an hour and a half. I've pulled over and I've paced on the side of the road. This is not an exaggeration. I have pulled over and just paced on the side of the road going, I can't do this. I can't. This is insane. Like, what are these people doing? Why is everybody out here? And then I just turned around. I'm like, dude, no, I'm not planning 3 hours to like go meet you for lunch. Like, when am I supposed to leave? Like 8:30
yeah.
for lunch? Like, yeah. No, I'll be down in Atlanta when I moved here to Atlanta. And you can come to Atlanta if you want to have lunch.
Plenty of restaurants around where I live.
Yeah, I hadn't seen Chris in years. Yeah.
So you moved there to start your solo career, and then you start writing country music.
Yeah, not really. I mean, yes, I did, but not on purpose. It just, maybe it's the
just
Georgia
came out.
Thing. I don't know. Too much sweet tea.
Dude, there's
and suddenly
you move to Georgia, you instantly write country music.
Absolutely. And
I don't even want to, and I still do.
See? You're doing it now. I can tell. Look in your eye. You just had it.
Coming up with a country song. Right,
it's about farm animals. And really what I didn't know if I was going to do music. And it just like naturally started happening. I think a lot of it was what I wound up doing is shaping some of those songs that were just like, I don't know, you're stuck in traffic. What are you going to do? I hadn't sold my car yet. And so you got nothing to do but write songs. I think I channeled a lot of that displacement coming from a place that was familiar and known to a place that still felt familiar in a sense. Still in the South, I can still talk like this and nobody's going to look at me funny. There's still sweet tea, you know. Everything's fried. It's great. So things are cool, except I've left a lot of friends back home and I'm finding a new place. And it's a big place and it's a very diverse, culturally diverse place. And I think a lot of what I was coming out with the country stuff, I was like, it's all still there percolating. Mm. Then I started trying to formulate, well, what does this mean in light of Jesus? And then it turned into what is Neon Steeple, which is about, or like a Google Earth view of what I find to be the meta narrative of all of Scripture, which starts in the beginning where it's union with God, displacement from union with God, and a longing to get back into union with God. And all of the rest of the story seem to follow that same, like the Israelites into bondage, out of bondage, into the promise, longing for, all of it feels like a longing for home, acceptance to be. And even the American Prodigal is taking it to, it's sort of a zooming in on a Google Maps neighborhood and making it personal. The prodigal story, same deal, coming home, you meet the father, and it's about what do we do with that journey of both rebellion and the response that God has shown us over and over and over and over and over and over. So yeah, this American Prodigal is really just like a progression from where I started with the Neon Steeple. In fact, the last words sung on Neon Steeple are, and I finally found my home. That was on purpose because we were then going to the American Prodigal story.
When you moved to Atlanta and you were kind of rediscovering music a little bit, and I watched something where you said, if we can't play it on the porch, we can't play it on stage.
That's true.
Did that become a little more difficult to do, like finding stuff that you can plug in on stage?
Well, here's the deal. That was only on the front end because it was like, you know, that was part of my progression to shed myself of where I'd been and to enter into something that was new. With the previous band entity, we were way nerdy and way into a lot of electronic stuff. And I wanted to get back to where I'd started, which was just sitting around playing music in the house. Was a piano that somehow magically was there. Mm-hmm. And there wasn't anything but just me and a piano in the house, and music came from it. That felt like real into the heart of a human, for one. And then it felt like you're just right in touch with, like, well, your insides immediately come out, and it doesn't take a lot of stuff to get them out. And I thought, I want to find people that can be around me and feel the same thing. I want to feel from them their heart without having a lot of accoutrements that help. You know, like a distortion thing is amazing. Thank you. Thank you so much, you know, for gain and electricity and all that. But at the same time, a human voice can break up in a way that you still feel all the dissonance of a baby's cry that doesn't match 440. So it's still there in us with a stomp and a clap.
There's something very organic and community when you start to do that, right?
Yes. And so I wanted to see, can you create the same hype and emotion without having to use technology? Because I had been so dependent on technology. Also, at the same time, I was very critical of technology internally. I was had a lot of just thought processes going on about how we interact with each other and how, what is community if you're sitting on the other side of a phone or a computer screen? Like, how close are we really? All that stuff, you know, the stuff that we all struggle with was in the middle of my music, I felt like. And so I wanted to try to strip things away. And community happens when you get a group of musicians and you have to sit around and make music happen that doesn't get recorded. It just is in the air briefly and then gone forever. And to be able to listen to that moment again only is about 100 years old. Like, it's just about 100 years old that we could do that. That's crazy to think of the span of humanity, and we think that that's how music is and happens, that a guy in a basement can make a song that goes around the world and people can listen to that song riding on a subway with headphones on and never, no one ever really interacts with anybody.
Yeah.
And I think it's cool that just the human voice, when you get a couple of others and you start to harmonize, also arguments kind of go away.
Yeah.
I think it's just community can form immediately, and there's commonality that can happen immediately when you just start playing together. And so I just thought, let me start there and then see how to build something on top of that idea. And I needed that for formation in myself. So it was sort of an experiment for me. I needed this. I needed community. The whole thing was about home, about finding people who were real and true and could be a part of life in a way that felt to the core of the thing. And anyway, I feel like I did.
Yeah.
And then you can add all the other stuff. I think if you have that foundation where you can look people in the eye and say, man, I'm with you in life, then it feels like cool. Also, what's your Instagram tag?
Yeah.
Because I want to see that. I want to see that too, because you're funny, man. I want to see what you said today. Ah.
A lot of that hanging out, jamming on the porch sound made it onto this record too. Like Keep Me, one of the first songs on the record, kind of has that feel as well.
One of the fun things about making this record, I was writing with several good friends now that, so we'd have like a couple of songs working in progress, and then I would go over to their house and be like, listen, bro, today we're going to finish this song. Look at me and I, we are not going to write another song. Keep Me is one of those days where it's like I had a workload. We were going to finish Garden. I go over to finish Garden. And I'm like, look at me and I. Dude, we are not going to write another song. And David Garcia's who, he looks at me and goes, okay, we're totally going to knock this out. Hey, check this out, though, right before you got here. I want you to hear this beat. And then Keep Me happens. And at some point, we have a verse and stuff, and he goes, hey, rap on this. I'm like, wait, what? He goes, rap on this. And I'm like, and I don't know, we've already got professionals doing this because we got, you know, Tadashi's on this record.
Yeah.
We got KB on this record. The 116 guys are like such good buddies, after, especially after being in Atlanta. And so I'm like, we've already got that covered, man. They don't need this. And you can't say rap and hillbilly is the same. And so we give it a go. And I'm like, well, promise me this. You won't say I rapped on this deal. You just say hillbilly talk fast in time. And then KB's safe. He doesn't feel any threat to his person. And so
you joined
Tadashi's
116
cool.
Now?
Yeah. I try to every day. I think I've got all the angles. Bend, reach, Lecrae, everybody, I got them all ready to go.
Hit me up, man.
Yeah, I'm ready to go. The devil keep calling, calling me back. Oh, I'm crying, I need your help. Keep me from trouble, keep me from hell. Oh, keep me walking, walking.
The next song is Run Devil Run, which was pretty cool that you got to share this song like during an NFL game, which I noticed. That's a pretty cool thing, right?
Man, I didn't have any idea about it. We were literally like me and Hank, who's in my band, you know, the game's on. It's like, I think it's a Sunday night game.
Like Kansas City, Pittsburgh or something.
That's
like that.
Yeah. And so it's on and we're watching it. But then we're in this like really deep discussion about something incredibly important. Just change the world kind of deal, like a new app that we've come up with that will be, all the kids are talking about it. All of a sudden, we stop talking, and both of us at the same time are like, is that something from, that's, and we look at the deal, about the time it dawns on us, it's gone, and we're like, no. And then we had to rewind it, and I was like, oh my word, and it was shortly after the record came out, and I was like, how in the world did this happen? And I guess professionals do this. That's what they do. They find great music and they put it on professional
sporting events. Somebody sent them the song.
Yeah.
They heard it from somewhere.
Much, yeah. I was into competitive sports. Challenges. I'm into those. I got something to make the devil go run.
Were you into sports as a kid?
Yeah, totally.
Yeah?
I played soccer.
Oh, obviously that. Mm-hmm. Anything else?
Track and field. Mostly just the track. No, some field, because cross country is through fields. So yes, track and field. And into basketball, I'm tall. I wasn't very good, but I was tall and could reach things. Also, the baseball, horrible at that. But my dad really wanted me to go and play the baseball. I did hit a home run and get carried off the field, like movie style.
Yeah.
When some of my parents' extended family was in town, and they just thought, like, I'm amazing. And it was really, the coach was like,
Major League,
how in the world did this happen? No, he's looking like, I don't know how this happened. I'm like, I don't know either, but this is amazing. Being carried off a field is awesome. But I was very small and lanky, I still am. So none of my uniforms fit really well. And so part of my childhood, you should see the photos of my sport teams. I tried football once because I was really good at track and field. I was very fast, they said. I was very fast. My goal in life was to run a 4-minute mile. I was going to be in the Olympics. That was like all I wanted to do, starting at age 11. That was my goal in life. I want to run in the Olympics and break a 4-minute mile. Never happened, obviously.
Instead, you ride a tour bus and play music. Like,
hey,
I don't know if that's
good work if you can get it.
You maybe missed the mark a little bit on the goal.
But anyway, I tried for football because the track coach talked me into going out. It's like, man, you make a great wide receiver. I'm like, okay, I don't think so, because y'all do like what they call two-a-days, which is in the heat of the Texas summer, and like that sounds like of no interest to me whatsoever. He's like, skip all that. Come to the first time we put on pads, and we'll just give it a try, see if you like it or not. I'm like, sweet. So I show up first time, and they tell me kind of the deal, like you're going to go out this way, run that way, and then catch a ball. I'm like, that's what we've done for like our whole life. That's great. And so I do it, and I catch the ball, and I'm thinking, there's nothing to this. At the time I'm thinking there's nothing to this is when my friend, who is a linebacker, totally annihilates my whole person, to which I'm like, this is the worst sport ever, and then leave. I just look at the coach,
the
take my helmet off, I take pads off, and I'm just walk. I leave the stuff on the field, and that was the last time
I've seen
football.
That TV show where the little kids, the little football kids, it's like
Pee Wee deal. There's like a name for it. Football,
I don't know. Texas, and they're like getting yelled at like they're adults.
Yeah. Like growing up in Texas, I know.
Right.
Yeah.
It's got to be a little damaging to the kid's self-esteem, I would think.
Yeah, that's why we're talking now. Thank you.
That's why I'm a musician and not playing football. man, my victory, this is like my stay in the car song. Like being in radio, you hear songs on the radio all the time in the building. But when this song comes on, like I stay in the car till it is done. Like this is my favorite song right now. And one of my friends, this is kind of where it hit me, like the first time I heard it, one of my friends has dealt with drug abuse for a while. And like one of the first times I heard your song, he had just gotten arrested again to go back to jail. Like he had got out of prison after like a decade. Mm-hmm. And then I see his picture, somebody posted on Facebook, one of those, like picture of the newspaper kind of thing.
Oh, man.
It's just like, dude, like when are you going to finally get it together? And then your song comes on, and like one of the first lyrics is, "You came for criminals, even ones like me came for fair." Like, and it hit me like, I'm just as much as a hypocrite as this dude. It was your song that kind of brought that to my attention that day, which I thought was pretty cool, and it's still one of my favorite songs we're playing.
Dude, that's amazing. Yeah, man, the stuff you're talking about, dude, that's, I've had a number of people in my life that have struggled with a lot of addiction stuff, and it's hard to watch, you know? But yeah, I felt, at the same time, I'm in the same boat. I mean, it's the story's the same for all of us. Mm-hmm. That's part of what I love about getting to tell this story over and over, and why it's told over and over in the scriptures. It's the story of humanity. And I think if you find that commonality, then you feel more connected and you put faces and names to a struggle that you can then see in yourself. That part's incredible. I love about this song, though, that it does then point to the cross and a thing that looks incredibly dire and devastating can be turned to tell a story of the grandeur of what rescue looks like and what redemption looks like and what the point of this story is to begin with. At times, it doesn't look it on the surface, but you know that God's active and at work, and you have to believe that, and you have to be with people in the moment, and that can get really tough, I know, but man, that just feels like an Easter song to me.
Yeah.
I know it's focused more on the cross, but boy, it sure feels like Easter. It feels like fist to the air, defiant.
And it's such a great reminder, like even the story of my friend, like it just seems like he's clean and then goes back and he's clean and he goes back. But even through all of that, even if he fights this the rest of his life, Jesus still came for him. Jesus still came for every mess up and every screw up that he's going to go through, that I'm going to go through, that we're all going to go through.
Absolutely.
And that song's a great reminder that I love it.
Man, the thing is, God loves you in your present tense as much as he loves you in any future tense that you have. Right now, wherever you are, he loves you as much as he will ever. And that part is like beautiful and devastating. That's what brings you back if you feel that and know that and have somebody in your life to tell you that and show you that. Oh, yeah.
The next song, Prove It, it talks about the freedom and just letting go of chains, man. I love the story behind this song.
Man, Prove It is thick. It's one of those songs that popped out before we had a lot of the conversation. Because a lot of this record feels very timely given the conversations we're having culturally and politically. That's all that is on the news. It's like no one saw any of this coming.
I saw someone post on Facebook the other day, I really just want to start seeing people's dinner again. Like, can people please start posting pictures of that again?
Dude,
that would be amazing.
Facebook is losing. I mean, everybody's dropping all their friends. Friends are like, oh, man, for real. This song is exactly what you just said. It puts us all in the same spot. The conversation might be about this, but it's really about the depravity in us.
Mm-hmm.
And when we see that the lines between us, somebody put there arbitrarily, and there's really one line, and that's the one between death and life. And that conversation is really one worth having. And thank goodness we had somebody stand there and span that gap for us. And the love your neighbor as yourself part, that changes the whole thing, you know? Because I like myself a whole lot. And most of what I read on the deal is like people not liking each other that much. And anyway, I think that would be like a great place to start. And when you walk across the street or walk next door and put a face and name, somebody you care about and love, then experience a life that might be very different than yours. It starts to shape your vantage point and your outlook, and it immediately transforms you.
I think it goes back to what you were just talking about. You know, like sometimes technology tends to separate us, but when you invite somebody over to hang out on your porch and just hang out, you start to attach like flesh and blood and emotions to the anger that you might be starting to feel towards them, and it changes the way you perceive them and the way you look at them.
Totally. That's it, man. Absolutely. I love that. It sounds so simple.
Yeah.
But it's so hard, you know?
Like, this is a real person. This is not someone I just type in, you know, whatever comments I want on social media.
You're immediately responsible for whatever comes out of your mouth.
Right.
You know? You immediately see all the micro expressions and the disappointment or the joy. And sure, it's a lot more fun to, like, see somebody's eyes light up and you know that you gave them life. We were on tour somewhere. I don't even know where it was. Somewhere in California, and some know it probably wasn't even a town. But it was a town. So I went to church, and the pastor was talking about the word encouragement. And it sounds so dumb. It's like so cliche. But he's like, you know, the word encouragement is like to put courage into someone. And I was like, okay, I'm messing with the language a little bit, but I see your point. And man, that has stuck with me for my whole life. If you can put courage into someone, it's so much more fun than robbing them of courage. Because you can say, the bad things you say to somebody live forever. You know, I can think of things that were said to me about my baseball uniform not fitting properly.
Yeah.
That happened in junior high. It has no implications on my life currently, but it's still hanging there. I can't remember what they said that was great about me. And I'm sure that same person said nice things to me. I can't remember any of them, but that one thing, sure, the bad things hang on for much longer. They're more tenacious, have claws, and they hold on. So wouldn't it be so much better to give life and put courage into people rather than rob them of what they might do down the road? Man, that lives with me.
I think also we've just lost the art of how to debate. Like, we just want to attack people and be angry all the time. Like, you know, if we actually approached it in love, even if it's the truth, I mean, God says speak the truth in love. I mean, the love part is what we forget, and then that leads to Facebook fights.
That's true. It just feels so good to burn somebody. You know, I mean, even, oh, come on. It's like, oh, I got them. Hey, check this out. Yo. I had this dude, he's an actor in town on a show that's filmed in town, kind of about this town. And
Nashville?
Anyway, he got on to me. He wrote a very long comment on my Instagram thing that was like about how I only follow like two people on my Instagram, but I talk about community a lot. And he thought there was like a dissonance between my verbalization of what community is and the fact I only followed like two people on Instagram. And he let me have the what for, and then there was a whole conversation that happened. But I don't typically engage that kind of thing. So I did like a passive aggressive engagement. So I followed him. So then it was just like the three of us. And then I was like, that felt so good. And I feel like, man, that's wrong what I'm feeling, because it feels so great. Because, like, I got you. And then he, like, then reprimanded me again. I was like, you're right. You're right. And so then I unfollowed him. And then I was turmoil because it sort of felt like another burn. I felt like I did it twice without ever saying anything. And I felt worse about the second time because I really felt bad about it. So sorry, I unfollowed you.
Sorry, that actor guy on
and
that
I didn't
TV
engage
show.
In real conversation within the community. Dude, on the internet,
one of the real reasons I follow you on Instagram is for Kenny Rogers' Arctic Fox. I mean, this is like the coolest thing ever. You just did like a short film with him too, right?
Oh, no. You have no idea what's coming. Yes, this is like just a taste. There's a lot of, it's going to be a great time. I just want people to know Kenny a little more, because everybody's like, what's the deal with Kenny Rogers, the Arctic Fox?
For those who don't know, what is the deal with Kenny Rogers,
the Arctic
what is
Fox?
It?
Well, first of all, you need to know that it's a girl dog, and also that Rogers is spelled with a D, as to not be confused with the gambler. Everything after that, you'll probably figure out. Her Instagram feed is Kenny Rogers, the Arctic Fox. Now, Arctic is more difficult to spell than you think it is.
Yes.
So you're going to want to get that right, and then everything will start to make sense. You'll see like her tagline. It's like, this is my life. I love everything about it. That's pretty much all of it. And so we follow her around. She's our fearless leader. So
now, why doesn't she move?
She's dead. She's an Arctic fox that is no longer living.
She's stuffed.
But as a family, can't let go of her. So that makes sense.
Yes.
I mean, if you follow her long enough, you'd probably figure that part out. At first, it gets confusing because you're like, wow, that dog is well behaved. And then you're like, I don't think that dog
moves. She hasn't moved in 15 minutes.
Yeah. And then you realize that now...
It is the weirdest, most entertaining thing on Instagram, probably, that I've ever seen.
Well, I can tell you, if you meet her in person, she's the softest thing you'll ever touch. Outside of cotton candy, if it's freshly made.
Another thing you do on social media is this hashtag my people,
yeah,
which I love because growing up in South Georgia, you see a lot of this, like just a lot of redneck stuff.
And it doesn't feel strange at all, right?
Doesn't feel odd at
all. Well, here's the deal. You remember you were saying like Atlanta's like a destination location? Well, when you go to a big city, all of a sudden you realize this is not normal for the rest of the people.
Yeah.
And at the same time, you're like, hang on a second, though. It seems like we're kind of brilliant comparatively. And I want to show you...
A little bit more creative.
I want to show you like how incredibly ingenuitive my people are. And I think it broadens the mind. It's like, who would think to do that? Probably not the average person living in the big city.
Yeah.
Because they don't
have
to. They can go like...
Texarkana, that's where they live.
Exactly. Texarkana, yeah. Texas is where they're from.
Now, where do you find all this stuff? Do you meet all these people? Like, how do you get your material?
What happened was it started like in person. And so I got really tickled about a few things that I thought, oh my goodness, this is funny to people. And this is like, you know, real life. And they think it's humorous. And then I see the humor in it. And so it started there. And then I was like, there's got to be more of us out there. And started digging on the internet, web machine, machine. And, at the time I think I've gotten to the end of the internet, suddenly I find like a whole nother...
There's more
of us out there than you think. What I want to do, though, is I want to go backwards and like track down all of these people and like hang with them for like a day. That would be fun.
That would be what we
do
South Georgia on a Friday night. We do nothing. We just go hang with
weird
people.
We go hang.
Yeah.
And then I say like, hey, here's how you think of putting a like real live doorknob on your car. It still works, and then your handle falls off.
You gotta go check out that hashtag my people, and you can see it on Crowder's Instagram. Another thing you'll notice if you go is obviously Crowder's luscious beard. Like, you have the best beard in Christian music, my friend.
All right.
That's a compliment.
I know. I was trying to think of that, if we can say that.
Yeah. Why?
Well, I don't know. It feels like, you said that. It feels like one of Chuck Norris kind of things. Conflating ideas, but you know what I'm saying. Like, I don't want to claim that you said that.
You do.
Because, I mean, I've seen people with beards.
You just celebrated No Shave November and never stopped. Like, it just kept going.
It happened in the year 2000.
Been going ever since.
Absolutely. But it was January.
I wanted to do an either-or type scenario of what might be hiding in Crowder's beard. Is that cool?
Absolutely.
Okay. What might be hiding in Crowder's beard? Cheetos or SpaghettiOs?
Cheetos.
Because I heard that Chef Boyardee is all up on your bus.
Yeah, it's been a while since I've had a SpaghettiOs, so Cheetos, the fiery ones.
What would be hiding in Crowder's beard? Winter Jam nachos or the hash browns from the Waffle House?
The nachos. I love nachos.
I saw a picture on Instagram where you were just pigging out at Instagram.
Oh my goodness.
I mean,
there's nothing like
Jam.
I don't like, if you go into like a nice restaurant and it's like, hey, do you want the nachos? And it comes with like a garden on top of it and a whole like poultry thing. No. I want like the cheese in the bag that they put in the deal that heats up and you squish it out.
Yes.
And like, I've gone to figure out how to buy that
for
my house.
The worst possible thing your body could ever take in.
Dude, no, I am like all about science food, man. If it's made by science, I want to eat that. So
one last
out on me.
What's more likely to be in Crowder's beard? White hair from Kenny Rogers' Arctic Fox or white hair from age?
Surely age. Yeah. I'm not. Yeah, yeah, yeah. I've got personal
space
issues.
You're not doing the Just for Men yet in the beard?
Better. Oh, yeah, totally.
Yeah.
I want all white, because then you look so wise. Like, you've got things to say. People will listen to you. They will pay attention. When you talk, they'll like be like, hang on, everybody be quiet. He's got something to say. Or he might do a magic, or, you know, that kind of thing. Those are both likely. Like, might do something magic.
Little kids' birthday parties. You're like doing magic tricks.
I'm thinking more like, dude, just turn the tree stump into a leprechaun. That kind of deal. Rather than like
the real deal magic. Yeah,
yeah. Bloom animals.
The real deal.
You don't need white hair for that.
Someone did tell me that there was a lot of Chef Boyardee on your bus. Are you still
the raviolis? Yeah.
Raviolis?
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
I think
you would rather
makes
eat
it,
that than catering. Is that what I hear?
No. Listen, we have great catering.
I'm not saying you don't, but I'm just saying your love for Chef Boyardee is up there.
It is. Also, the convenience of the thing. Because, like, the catering's indoors, outside of your bus. You have to walk outside for like
a long walk.
Yeah, a distance, and then you eat, and then you go back where you were. The can is like right there,
it's
and
on
you're
the
talking
bus.
About you're talking like a minute 30 seconds, and you have food, and it's like just convenience. That's why I don't shave. It's convenience.
Are you just like chilling on the bus all day eating Chef Boyardee before show? Is that what the typical show day looks like for Crowder?
And coloring. I love coloring.
Really?
Yeah, the adult coloring books that are really delicate and like you have to be real careful.
That I never pictured you as the one who would still be coloring.
I do that and just listen to 10th Avenue North. Color their color. They have coloring books, and so I color their coloring books and listen to 10th Avenue North. Yeah.
I think Jason Gray has some of those too. So you need to expand to other Christian artists who have coloring books.
Okay, great. I will track that down.
There needs to be more of them.
I agree with that 100%.
Yeah. The next song on the album that we're going to talk about is this song, Forgiven. Another one of my, if they're the top two songs on the album for me, my victory, Forgiven.
Oh, man. Bizarrely, we have similar tastes. For real. No, I'm not kidding. Mine is, I'd flip them and it would be like Forgiven, then my victory, but I don't judge you.
The rest of it puts me to sleep, quite honestly. I'm just kidding. It doesn't.
I'm resilient. Man, Forgiven, it's what we've been talking about, too. It's like the best thing you can say. Well, I can say it this way. So I've been married for 20 years, and one of the best things I think about marriage is it's like the best mirror you'll ever see yourself in, is because you see all your faults, and then at the same time, it's the best version of God in real live flesh, because they see you too with all your faults. And to be loved and accepted despite your faults that are known, and be loved as you, is like, it's amazing. And I have experienced it in real life so often. I hope that someone can hear simple melody and a few words strung together and the story God attached to it, and understand and know what I've felt in real life and been rescued by in real life. I know what forgiveness is because I've felt it in real life. And this song to me has a ton of that real life in it. The song started as Innocent was the chorus. And I'm like, and I was writing with a friend and I was like, I just don't think you get to say innocent until you felt forgiven. And then you understand that you're seen as innocent. And that's where the storyline eventually gets to.
Married for 20 years. I've only been married for 5. You ask for forgiveness a lot, so I can understand like the story behind the song. Your wife, Tony, like when you moved to Atlanta, she used to be on the road with you a lot, but now she's not. How's that working?
Man, first of all, like I get to like play and sing music. And I love it. It's amazing. But you can't necessarily, I don't care who comes in here, don't let them ever. It's not a job per se. You know, it's like there's nothing, this isn't a job. Right now, I'm just talking out loud. That's what I'd be doing if I was anywhere. I'd be probably talking out loud.
Hey, man, I'm a DJ. I need this job. I use my...
It's
a job.
It's a job.
We talk for a living, Crowder.
It's amazing. I sing beautifully, and it's... you should give me a career. No, she, like, works more than any person I know, and she's way more creative than I am. I mean, chick is a genius. So, yes, she now does, like, commercial design mostly.
Like Chip and Joanna Gaines kind of stuff, or what?
Yeah, but there's shiplap everywhere. Man, Chip and Joanna are like gold, man. They're a real deal. You know Chip? So
I don't know Chip. You probably do, don't you?
He had like a landscaping company. He was a fraternity buddy with my pastor of the church that we started in Waco. So he's in Waco. Obviously, he's in Waco. That's redundant, too. He would mow. Not mow, that's the wrong word, because we didn't really have a lawn at the church. It was just like a parking lot that had a lot of weeds that would grow.
Yeah.
And so Chip would come over and like weed eat our parking lot and spray the magic things and make it not come back for a while. And we'd be like, hey, let us pay you like $20. And he's like, man, you can't afford $20. You're a bunch of college kids. So he would do it for like nothing. And
look at him now.
I mean, come on. And Joanna had this cool shop that had the most eclectic, beautiful things you could ever put in one place at the same time, and one of the things she had them displayed on was this long table. And Tony, my wife, went over to her shop one day and was like, oh man, I love this. She's like, what? And she goes, the table that all the stuff is on. She's like, you can't have the table that the stuff is on. She goes, but it would look so great at the church. And Joanna's like, okay, we look great at the church. So anyway,
it's at the church.
It's at the church. It's when you come in. You know, I mean, they are just like gold, generous people. And it's so fun. And they were just killing it before anybody knew their name. I mean, they were just turning neighborhoods all over town into something.
So Waco knows them a lot better than everybody else.
Yeah, way before they were known by the world.
Like, we think
we know them. No, you know, I mean, pretty much what you're seeing, you know them. I mean, it's like, they're the deal, man.
Who would have thought that Chip and Joanna Gaines would have made it onto this interview with Crowder talking about American Prodigal?
Well, I was trying to figure out a way to segue into them, and you brought it up, so I was like, well, that's off my table.
When you're from Waco, you just think about ways to talk about Chip and Joanna, I guess, huh?
Yes, totally.
Yeah. The last song we're going to talk about on this album, All My Hope, just feels like a church hymnal, just hanging out, worshiping kind of song, man. I love it.
So the first time I thought I might be able to sing was when I first sang Because He Lives. The whole time before I sang that song out loud into like a microphone for real, I felt like I was always it was always a fight. It felt like a fight that I'm trying to like find pitch. I'm trying to make the note, trying to find the pocket. It just felt like a fight. And then all of a sudden I sing a Gaither song, Thank You, Bill and Gloria. And I was like, this is so natural. Like all of the ways it falls and I didn't have to think about it. Just felt like singing. This song, the All My Hope song, would feel like a little twist of the dial. It's a little more black gospel than where we were with the Southern gospel, but it made me understand that these are tributaries of the same stream, and it felt exactly the same in my throat. I remember when I was singing the vocal for this the first time, pretty much what you hear is like the first time it got sung, and I was singing like, it was with Ed Cash, and I'm like, dude, I can't pull that, because he sang like the rough, you know, give me a guide, you know, after mm-hmm. we kind of got the thing written. And I'm like, man, I don't know, man. And I'm like all nervous. And he's like, dude, just give it a go. And I sing like the first couple of lines and I just start laughing. I'm like, oh my gosh, what is that? By the time we got to the end of the song, my stomach hurt because I was just laughing. Like, this feels unbelievably natural. I can't believe that this is like in the wheelhouse, because it's nothing. It feels like when I discovered the Gaither Southern Gospel thing, I thought I was this pop guy. Mm-hmm. All of a sudden, you're like, no, wait, what's in your insides are in your insides, and they come out a lot more natural than what you've been told you should be. So I felt like, as a vocalist, both of these things helped me understand more about music in general, both the Because He Lives and then on this record, the All My Hope, helped me understand my voice and my person better.
Yeah,
if
yeah.
I could say that.
Come on and sing
I'm so grateful you're here to show the stories behind these songs, man. Thank you for going deep, and thank you for sharing more about you, too.
Man, you're too kind to allow me to do so, and I've enjoyed it thoroughly.
Thank you for listening to the More Than the Music podcast, episode 37, featuring Crowder. If you've enjoyed this episode, would you consider sharing it with your friends on social media? Any Facebook, Twitter, or Instagram share only helps more people hear the amazing stories behind these songs. I also love hearing your stories, and you can email me anytime at justin@wayfm.com. I got this email this week from Sonia. She said, I'm so thankful for your show. I'm a born-again believer, but often feel isolated. I seldom go to church, but have been inspired in my faith and encouraged by the faith I hear on your show. She says, I'm on my own a lot because my husband protects rhinos at a conservancy in Zimbabwe. She goes on to say, I was visiting my parents in California last year and somehow found your show on the podcast app. An app I've never used before, so I honestly believe it was God leading me to your show. She said, I downloaded a whole bunch because our internet in Zimbabwe is not always fast enough to download. There are so very many challenges out here, but I am thankful for your show. Sonia, thank you for listening. Thank you for sharing your story. Honestly, this is why I do the show. Not only to connect you to the artists that you love, but so you can hear the stories behind these songs in hopes that it encourages you. You can connect with the show too at wayfm.com/Justin. You've even got a chance there to win an autographed copy of Crowder's American Prodigal that was featured in this episode.